ZDF@Bauhaus. Die Vereinigung von Schall und Rauch.
Heute mit einer Band, die waren schon mit Depeche Mode auf Tour, da hatten sie noch nicht mal selbst ein Album raus. Es ist eine Band, die unter Beweis gestellt hat, dass Glasgow den Namen Stadt der Musik zurechtträgt. Es ist außerdem eine Band, die gezeigt hat, dass ein kleines V eine sehr große Wirkung haben kann. ZDF at Bauhaus mit Churches. That's your stage.
Be a thorn in your side for Guten Tag. Wie geht's? Ich spreche ein bisschen Deutsch, aber es ist nicht gut. Entschuldigung. We're a band called Churches. Thank you very much for coming out to see us and for sitting in such an organized way. It's very neat, but thank you very much. We're going to play a bunch of songs which are on our record.
Come for. And it's you I'll come for. you just came from Australia, sold out tour, and critics all over Europe love what you do. What has all the shit done to you?
Nothing, really. Like, not for us personally, like as human beings, as musicians, we're exactly the same, you know. That was always something that was important to us, that we wouldn't be affected by anything that was going on around us, and that was kind of our mantra from the first day that the band started. And when people kind of initially started talking about the record or the songs that we'd released, that we would never be that band that kind of got seduced by everything that was being written about you, because as soon as you start doing that, you become shit. It's happened many times before. It's not going to happen to us.
Yeah, you're right, but still, I mean, your daily schedule must have changed.
Well, yeah, that's changed, yeah. I mean, we're very busy, but we're working hard. We are a band that, like, working hard is everything to us. You know, this is a really great chance. Well, it doesn't come along every day, and we would look back on it with regret if we didn't, you know, buy into all the kind of schedule stuff and just do as much as we could in the time that we have.
Ian, do you remember a special point within the last couple of months or years where you said, oh my God, this band is going to be awesome? More awesome than my other bands before, maybe.
I don't think I've ever really considered the awesomeness of the project, but that's kind of for other people to decide, I guess. But yeah, no, I think the moment, the day that we put Lies on the Neon Gold blog last year was when we realised, I think, well, when I personally realised that, oh, people are actually interested in this in a really new and exciting way. I'd never really experienced that with any of the other projects that I'd been involved with. And so that day was a very significant day, I think, for us as a band and for me personally.
And Lauren, I mean, the two guys were, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, I think the two of you, you were like producing a demo tape and we were looking for a singer, right? And then you got to know Lauren.
Not entirely, no. We were just kind of working as friends with no real idea or roadmap. We'd recorded maybe 3 or 4 songs, but we didn't have like ambitions to start a band or like try and, you know, turn it into something that was successful. But when it kind of fell in at the right time that I heard Lauren singing, that Ian played me the demos that they'd worked on together, and it felt like a really natural and interesting fit to try and do some stuff together, and we kind of took it from there. Yeah.
And how did you know that Churches is probably more important than the other bands before?
Oh, I don't... I think it was just like we were working on a bunch of things concurrently, and this is just a thing that people seem to gravitate towards more, and it was just taking up more and more of our time. So now we're lucky enough to not have other jobs and get to do this as a job, which is quite cool.
Faster, you won't go far. Shouldn't leave feeling vain. People know.
Thank you. So, our album came out a couple of weeks ago, which is very exciting. It's actually real. It exists. People have it in their hands. Well, not here, but in the world in general. It's really nice for us to get to come and play in Germany because people have always been very supportive of us here. So it's nice to come and do this as our first proper bit of like playing on German TV. So thanks for having us.
It feels a bit like a kind of small community theatre or something.
And we'll be like, yeah, we'll be having a small intermission if you want to go to the bathroom or get snacks. But unfortunately, there is no intermission. You have to stay. The doors are locked. You can't get out. They're not locked. If there's a fire, you can't leave.
Maybe we could get some ice cream.
We should have thought that through. We would have brought sweets like at the pantomime. And just, is that a thing here? Christmas pantomime. Oh, Church's Christmas pantomime coming soon. Not really. We were like writing a record. We didn't have time to write a pantomime, but maybe next year. This is a song called Strong Hand, and it has the album title in it. Why don't you tell me, what do you mean? There is a blank page for you. Give me the bones of what you believe. Maybe they'll save you from me. Will I be the strong?
You all played in other bands before, and actually, from my point of view, it was different music, more rock and singer-songwriter stuff. How, why did your album turn out to be an electro-pop kind of thing?
It wasn't necessarily something that we had like grand plans to do. It was really just something that that came out as a result of where we were recording. Like, we were working in a basement studio in Glasgow where there wasn't room for drums or like a big band set up, and I had been buying a bunch of synthesizers that year, and Martin and I sat down initially to start working on stuff, and those were the things that we gravitated towards: drum machines, synths, samplers and stuff like that. So I guess it was maybe also symptomatic of the stuff that we were listening to at the time and had been for some time, you know.
This kind of project was was exactly what had been in my mind for a long time, and when it was the right time for everyone to try something like that, it was good.
Obviously it was good, but still there's people saying that the whole electropop thing has reached its peak. Do you think about those, you know, things?
No, I don't think we're an electropop band either. Like, I think that's...
What do you think?
I think we're a rock band that play non-traditional rock instruments. Like, I think we're like a... We come from a live music world, you know. We understand how to write songs on the guitar or on the piano. But when you write with electronic instruments, it takes your brain to a more unique place, you know, a place that you can't get to on the guitar. And that creates a different sound, you know. It's very much in the way... If you look at, like, the way the Yeah Yeah Yeahs, you know, made a record that was full of synthesizers, they were still an alternative rock band, or still a live band, but they were using synths instead of guitars.
You've played in so many bands, and then you produce music for a long time, and that now finally something more is going on, and you have the whole promo stuff and interviews and TV shows and whatever. What is the good thing about it?
The good thing, as Lauren's already alluded to, is that you get to do this kind of thing for a job, you know? It's like you get to play, you get to write music, and you get to play it with your friends in cities across the world and have people sing the songs that aren't even released yet, and, you know, all those things are really positive and really encouraging.
That's pretty cool, definitely. But you have just written an article for The Guardian for the bad things of the whole stuff. Tell us about it.
I guess it's the downside of being a band that was brought to people's attention on the internet. You're kind of fodder for trolls, internet trolls. So yeah, we get that when we were running the Facebook messages ourselves. But yeah, so some of that stuff is quite depressing sometimes, but mainly depressing about the state of humanity and why people would ever say those things to another human, let alone somebody they've never met.
You're talking inappropriate comments, sexual comments, things like this. Actually, you're one of the first persons ever, as far as I know, who wrote about it in public and talk about it in public. Why is that?
When we talked about it, it was in relation to like what happens to us in our day-to-day work. That stuff happens to women all the time, and probably to men as well, but that's not something that I know about, and we can only talk about what we know. But that happens to people every day, that people get spoken to like that. So I don't think it's a political thing. We weren't like making a stand or anything. It's just talking about what was actually happening. So,
but it's you wouldn't go as far as to say the whole social media thing is bad for
no
being
not at all.
In public,
I think that's why,
right?
We started talking about this, because yeah, we've been really lucky to get loads of support from social networks, and that's why it was important to us that we keep updating them and keep having that kind of connection with people. When you open the door to lots of amazing people, you open the door to a few assholes. So, you know, it's not a big price to pay. And I think that we'd like to keep doing that kind of contact with people. So, you know, you just delete the trolls from the page until they go away.
Come
Thank you. We're going to play a few more songs, including this next song, which is, I think, in my mind, the guitar song. It's a song called Tether.
Where'd you go? You were there by my side. Keep believing it's my turn to hide. In a place where we don't have a prayer, there's a tether that's keeping me there.
We just mentioned, you said you were a rock band, but using no classic rock instruments in a way. How, and that's important for me as a music nerd, how do you know when a song is finished? How do you know this synthy and this synthy and this drum machine and this vocals and the other vocals, this is good and now it's perfect song?
You never know.
You know, yeah, I don't know. And I'm kind of a obsessive tweaker in the studio. Like, I know that a song is finished when it's the night before it needs to be handed in for it to be sent to a master engineer or a mixer. Like, that's when it's finished for me. But, you know, you got to impose sanctions on each other. Mm-hmm. Deadlines are good. I like a good deadline. Otherwise, you know, then it's over. You have no choice. Happy or sad, you got to let it go. I mean, that's, you know, that's the way it should be.
Is there a song where maybe it's different, is there a song where the three of you say, wow, this one is so awesome when we play it live? Which one would it be?
I don't know if we go about referring to ourselves as awesome, but again, but...
Trust me.
I think the one that gets a really amazing reaction live is The Mother We Share. But I don't know if that's just where we put it in the set. It's normally the song that we finish with, or if it's the one that everybody knows, or I don't know, but it seems to get a really great reaction from people that come to see us.
There's a song on the album called By the Throat that was like one of the songs I liked. It wasn't my favourite song on the album, but it wasn't until we started playing it live that it kind of took on a whole new sort of meaning for me.
In which way?
Just, I think I really understand, you know, it's funny to say that something that you were heavily involved in the writing process with that you didn't completely understand until it was done, but I didn't, and not until I saw the way that people reacted to it and the way that, you know, the way that it went down live and the way that, you know, that those bass frequencies translate through a PA system, that I didn't fully get it. And then once we started playing it live, I was like, okay, right, I get it.
Get it.
That was a good moment, actually, when we played that song live for the first time. It's like, oh, okay, people like this. This is good.
This is how it works. Nice. So, I guess there will be plans. I mean, this is the first album, and you're on the promo tour, and you're doing a couple of live shows, going back to Glasgow then. Probably, as every musician who sits here, you work on new songs, right?
Of course. Otherwise, you have to like get another job because you don't write any more songs. Well, this is a writing project first and foremost, you know. It's where I feel happiest. I feel like it's where we're all happiest is in the studio. And, you know, working on material. Being a live band is a lot of fun, but I don't think it compares to the satisfaction of really crafting something from nothing in the studio. And that's
interesting. There's a lot of people saying the opposite. I mean, a lot of musicians like studio and getting out albums and stuff, but being on stage is like the best moment, a lot of people say. What do you say, Lauren?
I guess all bands start differently, and if you always thought you were going to be a live band and like playing on stage is like where you were born, then I imagine that feels different. But then sometimes that stuff's really difficult to recreate on a record. Like, you always hear about bands that are really awesome, like really intense live bands, but then it just doesn't appear on the record and it's kind of lackluster and it's not the same. So I guess for us, we never really thought about it as a band when we were starting. We were just writing things. So that's probably like, that's where we come from, and that's the nostalgic element. And then it was really fun for us to figure out how to do that live and what we wanted the live show to be. So I guess we just did it the opposite way up than we normally should, but.
Good night. Hello, is that right? Yeah, this is a song that's from our album that I sing. It's called Under the Tide.
I'm watching you run, run from the sailors. Taking a breath, filling your lungs. Keeping you alive. No fear, won't be your eyes, won't be your lifeline. And if I can be, I'll be your strength, and it won't be long now. But if you don't care, why are we here? What do you have left? Head up, keep holding, holding your head up. Head up, keep holding, holding up. High up, high up, high up.
And then we have to go because we're playing in Glasgow tomorrow. So we've been in Glasgow and then back here and then going right there. So, yeah, thank you very much for coming out to see us. And I guess it'll be on these cameras at some point too. So if you're watching at home, thanks for watching. And hopefully we'll see you guys this month when we're on tour. Dankeschön. Tschüss.